So hello everyone, how are you all doing? This is Dr. Vivek Goyal and I hope you can see and hear me as well. If you can hear me, please give me a thumbs up on the chat so that I get an affirmation and I will start my session. Please give me a thumbs up if you all are ready and you can hear me crystal clearly. Superb, superb. So, without any ado, let us begin the session and So I can see Dr. Sahil Bansal, Dr. Anil Kumar all have given me a thumbs up. And with this, I shall start my session. Hello everyone, this is Dr. Vivek Goyal. I'm faculty of nephrology at Doc Tutorials. I have also authored the book, The Nephrology Question Bank, one of a kind of nephrology question bank containing more than 1,000 plus solved nephrology MCQs, which have been used for numerous entrance examinations. So today we shall be discussing a very, very important topic of nephrology, which unanimously most of you have requested me in your messages to take it live. Now at the very outset, so please, how's the Josh? How is the Josh? And I expect high, sir. I expect the Josh to be high. Though the surroundings may not be that conducive, patterns have changed recently. But yes, I repeat, how's the Josh? And I want all of you to give me the answer that we all want to hear. Alright. Superb, superb. And I would like to begin today's session with the very famous quotation by my role model. And I always keep this quotation printed on my study desk, that if your dreams don't scare you, they aren't big enough. So my fellow students, my colleagues, my dear medico aspirants, what I want to tell you is, please dream high, always hitch at the sun, so that even if you fail, you shall land up on the moon. You know that the surroundings have not been that conducive. Very recently, the NBE has changed a lot of pattern. So, you know, especially for those who had already been preparing for the super speciality in the 60-40 pattern, it has been quite an alarming, you know, circular. But trust me, it is the same for all. Do not panic. You know, the winners are those who in these difficult situations don't worry about the consequences. They just put in the best of effort. And you know, what is it? Just do what is in your hand and leave the rest. Do your best and leave the rest. Also, a word of, you know, a pat on the back and a word of concern and a word of, you know, encouragement to my pathology mates, to my anesthesia mates, to my radiotherapy mates, who specially had a beating because they've now had to appear for the medical stream in its entirety, to appear for the DM hemat onco or be it the med onco or be it the critical care. So I do understand that, you know, it has been difficult, but do not worry. We at Doc Tutorials are with you always. Any doubt, any time, 24/7, we are there with you on WhatsApp as well as on the Facebook pages. So you can easily contact us, okay? And I shall, you know, try to cater to those students also who might not be that adept with this topic of renal tubular acidosis. So I shall try to start with the basics, and it shall help one and all, okay? And of course, the last thing which I always tell to myself, if you don't sacrifice for what you want becomes a sacrifice. So my dear students, the exam is on the 13th and 14th of November. Less than 2 months are remaining for your exams. So, you know, push the pedal hard and buck up yourselves. because you know whatever you might you'll be doing in the next 2 months, you shall be practicing for the next 40 years. Okay. Now, just a second. Students are telling me to increase the volume. So, just a second. Let me see if I can do something. Yeah. So, you know. So if you could just excuse me for a bit. Hello. Yeah, the students are telling me to increase the volume. Am I not being audible? Sorry. Okay. वॉल्यूम नहीं आ रहा है मेरा क्लियर वॉल्यूम सुनाई दे रहा है सर यू नो जस्ट टेकन अ पॉज फॉर द 2 सेकंड्स द टेक्निकल टीम इज ट्राइंग टू यू नो इंक्रीज द वॉल्यूम Yeah, so now let us begin with the session and yes, so let us start with the basic physiology first. So we all know this is the proximal convoluted tubule, and we know in the proximal convoluted tubule, 2 things importantly, you know, a lot of things get reabsorbed, but for us and with the topic at hand, 2 things are getting reabsorbed here. One is the bicarbonate, which is the chief base. So bicarbonate is reabsorbed through the PCT. And of course, we have the citrate being reabsorbed through the PCT. Now, please remember the citrate thing also. Now, if the bicarbonate reabsorption through the PCT is at fault through whatsoever reason, the reasons we shall study, so this bicarbonate reabsorption shall not take place. And if there is a defect in the reabsorption of the bicarbonate, you know, you shall lose the base. So if you lose the base in your body, you develop something which is known as acidosis, because you lose the base from your body. Because you lose the base from your body, and it's a defect of the proximal convoluted tubule, so it's a tubular defect, so it is known as tubular acidosis. And because the PCT is not a part of the liver, it's a part of the kidney, so this is known as renal tubular acidosis type 2. In short, we call it RTA type 2. So, you know, many students tell me that, sir, RTA is very, very volatile. I study it very often, but I tend to forget it again and again. Because, you know, what your mind does not know, your eyes cannot see. But I feel the corollary is also true. What your eyes have not seen, your mind does not register. So today what I want you all is to see the channels in front of your eyes. Though it's a schematic diagram, it's a crude diagram, do not go open your Brenner's and your Ganong's and compare it with this defect, because it's a schematic diagram. I have drawn only what is important to me at this situation, okay? So what is RTA type 2? It's a defect of bicarbonate reabsorption, and just keep in mind about this thing as well. Just keep it in mind. Next. Now, this, as we know, is the thick ascending loop of Henle. Is the thick ascending loop of Henle. And please see, sodium and potassium are reabsorbed here in exchange of two chloride ions through the thick ascending loop of Henle through the sodium potassium 2 chloride symport, which is coded by the gene SLC12A1. And if there is a loss of function mutation, henceforth, please write this, I shall write LOF for loss of function, GOF for gain of function, and hashtag for mutation. This is of course not an international terminology. This is my terminology. That's a shorthand to make you explain clearly. Okay. So if by any chance there is a loss of function mutation of this channel, so sodium does not get reabsorbed, so you get hyponatremia. The potassium does not get reabsorbed, so you get hypokalemia. Always remember, for the easy understanding, that usually potassium and hydrogen are best friends, most of it. So whenever there is hypokalemia, there is also alkalosis, because there is also hydrogen getting lost. So what you get here is metabolic alkalosis. Also, you will also lose water from here, so you will get a hypotension. So you also have a low blood pressure. So there is a syndrome of hyponatremia, hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, and hypotension. And of course, you know what syndrome I am talking about. This is none other than your Bartter syndrome. None other than your Bartter syndrome. Now, very interestingly, you have understood that Bartter syndrome, if nothing else is mentioned, you know it is the defect of the sodium potassium 2 chloride symport, which is coded by the gene SLC12A1. Now, just see, just anti-clockwise, do not apply any effort here. Just write down 1 here, 2 at the ROMK channel, 3 at the chloride channel on the basolateral aspect, which is the CLC and KB channel, 4 at the beta subunit of the channel, which is known as the Bartin, and 5 at the calcium sensing receptor, on the basolateral aspect. Just write down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, many of you might be thinking that why has Sir made us write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 anti-clockwise? You will be happy to know that just now you have learned and understood the 5 types of Bartter syndrome. These are the 5 types of Bartter syndrome. Now, I shall tell you what important MCQ points to know about these, but for the time being, just remember this. So, you know, what are we doing? We are correlating physiology with pathology, with genetics, with nephrology. So, we are learning physiology first and then learning the diseases about it, so that everybody understands the concept. Okay. Now, come to the next segment of the tubule, which is the distal convoluted tubule. Now, in the distal convoluted tubule, what gets reabsorbed? You have the sodium chloride co-symport, which is coded by the gene SLC12A3. Now, please understand, if due to any problem whatsoever, this does not get reabsorbed, so there is a loss of function mutation of this channel, which is sodium chloride co-symport. What will I get, sir? Sir, I will get a hyponatremia, a hypokalemia, a metabolic alkalosis. I will get a hypotension. So, sir, I will get something which is very similar to what I got earlier. Now, also remember, the pharmacological inhibitor of this channel is, yes, your thiazide diuretic. So is this syndrome not simulating as if I have blocked the person with a thiazide diuretic? You are absolutely correct. And this syndrome is known as Gittleman syndrome. Gittleman syndrome. Please mispronounce it as Gittleman syndrome. Why do I call it Gittleman? I will tell you again. And do not worry. All right. So now you have understood about this as well. Moving on. Now come to the cortical collecting duct, and this is your principal cell of cortical collecting duct. Okay, now please understand what happens in the principal cell. Now in the principal cell, very importantly, the mineralocorticoid acts on its receptor and it completes three important functions. It contributes to sodium reabsorption through the ENaC channel. It pushes out potassium out of the cell through the renal outer medullary potassium channel, and it pushes out hydrogen, that is the acid, through the channel as well. So what am I getting? I am getting sodium inside, I am getting potassium outside, I am getting acid out. Also, I am getting water inside through the aquaporins. So basically, I get sodium and water reabsorption and potassium and acid excretion. Now, you do know that the pharmacological inhibitor of this channel is aldosterone antagonist, which you all know by the name of spironolactone. This is the pharmacological inhibitor. You all know, we all have studied. Now, please try to understand. If in this channel there is a mutation, if say there is a gain of function mutation through this channel, what will happen? All the sodium will get reabsorbed. I will get more of sodium in the body. Will that? It will lead to hypertension, because more sodium is getting reabsorbed here. Eventually, I will get a hypokalemia, because in the distal part of the collecting duct, they will get lost. Secondly, I will get a state of metabolic alkalosis. So, sir, what have I got? I have got something due to the gain of function mutation of the ENaC channel, which is increase in the sodium, loss of potassium, increase in blood pressure and metabolic alkalosis. And what is this syndrome known as? Sir, this is the Liddle's syndrome. This is the Liddle's syndrome. We have studied it so often but could not register. Why? Because you had not seen it in front of you. Now you can see the Liddle's literally in front of you. Please visualize the channel and visualize this syndrome. Now, if there is a loss of function mutation of this very channel, it will lead to a syndrome which is the exact mirror image of the Liddle syndrome. And what is that known as? That is known as pseudo hypoaldosteronism type 1. It is the exact opposite of Liddle syndrome, which is known as pseudo hypoaldosteronism type 1. Now also, please understand one more thing here. Now, aldosterone acts on the mineralocorticoid receptor, but if for due to any reason, if either there is a decrease in the action or decrease in the production of aldosterone, what will happen? What will happen is the potassium shall not get excreted, so there will be a hyperkalemia in the blood, and the H plus ion will not get excreted. So there will be a metabolic acidosis in the blood. And do you know what is this syndrome known as? Yes, you are correct. This is renal tubular acidosis type 4. This is the RTA type 4 because of the decrease in the quantitative or qualitative action of the aldosterone on the mineralocorticoid receptor in the principal cell of the cortical collecting duct. I hope I am absolutely clear to you. Now moving on. Yes, now we have come to the main thing. What is this, sir? This is the alpha intercalated cell of the cortical collecting duct. So what is so special about this? What is so special about the alpha intercalated cell of the cortical collecting duct? This alpha cell of the cortical collecting duct is the chief site of acid secretion. That is, it is the main site of urine acidification. Please understand this, that it is the chief site of urine acidification. And how does it do it, sir? It has two acid secreting channels. One is the proton pump and one is the proton potassium antipode. If due to any reason these channels get defective, so these channels do not work, what will happen? Sir, I will get an acidosis in my body, which is of course due to the defect of the renal tubule. So that will be renal tubular acidosis type 1. It will be type 1. Now please tell me, what will happen to the potassium in RTA type 1? Sir, very easy. The potassium which was to reabsorb from the urine into the cell and then to the blood will not take place, and I will lose the potassium in the urine. Hence, it will lead to hypokalemia. So RTA type 1 has hypokalemia. But just now I told you, please remember in the very previous slide, in RTA type 4 there was hyperkalemia. Just try to recall these and then we will assimilate all the information in a tabular form, and nobody will can ask you a question which you cannot answer, be it any entrance exam, be it the NEET PG, the NEET SS, the USMLE or the MRCP. Okay? Moving on. Now one thing I might have just not told you. Yeah. Now I did tell you here that the loss of function mutation of this SLC12A3 is known as Gitelman syndrome. Now if this channel has a gain of function mutation, so now it is working exactly the opposite. What is it doing? It is taking all the sodium, all the chloride inside. So I will get increase in sodium in the body. Again later on, what will I get? Here I will get a hypertension, and what will I get? A metabolic acidosis. I will get the exact mirror image. So I will get any increase in sodium, increase in blood pressure, metabolic acidosis and hyperkalemia. And what is it known as? Yes, it is a gain of function. You know, there is only one gainer in this world, which is the God. So this is known as the Gordon syndrome. So what is Gordon syndrome? It is the exact mirror image of Gitelman syndrome. Why Gitelman? Because T for Gitelman, T for thiazide. It is the same channel where thiazide is at. Okay. Yes. So now we have read enough about the physiology part. We have understood enough about physiology. And we have, you know, studied almost everything what we want to study. Now what we shall do is, we shall just assimilate the information. And what I want you all to do is, now I want you all to answer, okay? So that I can understand that you all have understood what I have taught you till now. Now let's come to the topic of renal tubular acidosis. Now, what is renal tubular acidosis? It is a disorder of the renal tubules leading to impaired acid excretion in the urine. That is, it is a disorder of impaired acid handling by the renal tubules. There is impaired acid handling by the renal tubules. So what basically the RTA is, that in RTA, what happens is the kidneys are not able to manage acid properly, especially the renal tubules, because it's a disorder of the renal tubules. Okay. the work of the renal tubule was to excrete the acid in sufficient amount in the urine, but it is not able to do so. So what happens? There is accumulation of acid in the body and leads to a state of metabolic acidosis, and hence the term renal tubular acidosis. But by definition, the glomerular function is preserved. So please understand this important concept that per se due to RTA, the renal glomerular function will never be disturbed. It might so happen that the patient has a glomerular disease in the background. That's a separate story. But RTA is out and out a disorder of the renal tubule. Nothing to do with the renal glomerular or the filtration barrier. Okay? Wonderful. Now, before moving further, many students tell me that, sir, we never understand the concept of urine anion gap. Now, if you don't understand the concept of urine anion gap, then very many MCQs you will have a very lot of difficulty in solving, because urine anion gap is directly, indirectly asked in very many exams. So what is urine anion gap? So urine anion gap, if we abbreviate as UAG, is the difference of the urine cations and the urinary anions. Very simple. Now, please understand this, that urinary acid, that the main form of urinary acid is the urinary ammonium ion. This is also an MCQ. That the chief form of acid secretion by the kidney in the urine is in the form of ammonium ion. This is again an MCQ. Now, usually ammonium is excreted in the form of ammonium chloride. This is again a very, very important MCQ. Okay, so now can I draw this conclusion? You know, in mathematics, in class 9 or 10, there always used to be a question asked that prove this is equal to this, and I used to never be able to do that. But just to, you know, act over smart, what I used to do, I used to write a long solution with of course was wrong, and in the end I used to write LHS is equal to RHS, hence LHS is equal to RHS. But of course the teachers were smarter and I never got marks. But here I can prove you something, so let me redeem myself. So I know that urinary acid is directly proportional to urinary ammonium ion, I just now told you this, which is directly proportional to urinary chloride. So can I say thus urinary chloride is a surrogate marker of urinary acid excretion? Can I say this or not? Yes, I can say this, hence proved. So I can tell you that more the urinary ammonium, more the urinary acid. I hope I am absolutely clear. Now, what happens in RTA? In RTA, I told you there is less of urinary acid excretion. In short, there is less of urinary ammonium excretion. Hence, there is less of urinary chloride excretion. It's a very, very simple correlation. Now, if something is A minus B and if B decreases, so I just now told you that urinary anion gap is equal to urinary sodium plus potassium minus urinary chloride. I just now told you this. Yes? So now I told you, just now I told you, just a second. Yeah. So now, just now we studied that. In RTA, the urinary chloride is less. So if this decreases in RTA, we know if something is A minus B and B decreases, this will increase. So in RTA, the urinary chloride is less, thus there is increase in urinary anion gap. Can you understand the simple correlation? Can you? That is why the thumb rule in RTA, the urinary anion gap is always positive. This is a dictum. Take it to your grave, sir. Always remember this. Never ever forget this. Golden rule that in RTA, the urine anion gap is always, always positive. Now, I hope all of you are with me. All of you are still with me. Can you understand the concept? If yes, please give me a thumbs up. Please give me a thumbs up on the chat if you can understand and hear me properly. Come on. Are you there with me? The concept of urine anion gap? Yes, Dr. Abhishek Sharma, Dr. Darshan, Dr. Nitish. You were correct when you said Gordon's. Please give me a thumbs up if you can easily comprehend what I am telling you. The concept. I am waiting for the thumbs up. Superb, superb. So Anil Kumar, Dr. Anil Kumar has given me numerous thumbs up. So I hope he is happy and he's understood what I am trying to tell you. Wonderful, wonderful. Alright, so you have understood this very, very important concept. Now also, please understand, the normal urine anion gap is equal to plus 30 to plus 50 millimoles per liter. Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you so much. So this is the normal urinary anion gap. Okay. Alright. Now. So just, we know the normal urine anion gap is this much. Now, say, coming to a situation where there is a diarrhea. We know that the exact close differential of a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, the two important ones are diarrhea and RTA. Now, in diarrhea, we know that the urinary acid excretion is normal because the kidneys are normal. So there will be increase in urinary ammonium ion. So there will be increase in urinary chloride and hence the anion gap will be low. So what is the anion gap there in urinary anion gap in diarrhea? It is minus 20 to minus 90 millimoles per liter. And in RTA, we know that there is decrease of urinary ammonium excretion. So the urine anion gap in RTA is minus, it is obviously plus, I told you, plus 20 to plus 90 millimoles per liter. I hope I am clear to you. So the normal urine anion gap is plus 20, plus 30 to plus 50. In diarrhea, it is obviously negative. It is minus 20 to minus 90. In RTA, it is plus 20 to plus 90. Wonderful. Now, coming to another very, very important concept. Very, very important concept. It is not asked that often, but I would like my students to know everything. Okay? Okay? So what is urine osmolal gap? It is a difference between measured urinary osmolality minus calculated urinary osmolality. Sir, how do we find what is measured and what is calculated? The measured osmolality is through the osmometer. Yes, we all know that. Why increase urinary ammonium? Because in diarrhea also there is metabolic acidosis. You do know that because you lose the base through the gut. And because there is metabolic acidosis, there is a compensatory tendency of the body to excrete the acid from the body. And because we know that the kidneys are the chief form of excretion, the kidneys are intact in diarrhea, so they will excrete extra acid in the body, from the body. Okay, Dr. Naresh? Wonderful. And how do we find out how do we calculate the urinary osmolarity? Sir, very easy. It is 2 into the product of sodium plus potassium plus 1 plus glucose. We all know in obviously the molar units of all. So this is the measured and the calculated urinary osmolality. Now we know that the urine osmolality is actually comprised by, formed by the salts of sodium, potassium, of course by BUN, urea also comprises the osmolality, glucose also, if at all glucose is coming in the urine, and the ammonium salts. So this is what is forms the urine osmolality. And in calculated osmolality, if you can clearly notice, sir, we have taken into account sodium, we have taken into account potassium, we have taken into account BUN and glucose, but sir, we have not taken the ammonium salts in the calculated osmolality. So if we subtract this from this, what is left? What is left? I hope I am making sense to you. So can I say that the urine osmolal gap actually represents urinary ammonium excretion? Yes or no? Yes, sir. It does represent the urinary ammonium excretion. So, therefore, urine osmolal gap is also a surrogate for urinary acid excretion. Very, very important. Very, very important. But, what is the advantage of urine osmolal gap? The advantage is, it is a surrogate of urinary acid excretion. It is a surrogate of urinary acid excretion because it's a surrogate of urinary ammonium excretion. And that ammonium can be excreted in the form of chloride or non-chloride salts. So whether the acid is excreted in the form of ammonium chloride or non-ammonium chloride salt, non-chloride salt, it will be taken into account in the osmolal gap. But urine anion gap, versus urine osmolal gap, if I say, sir, urine anion gap, it does not account for non-chloride salts of ammonium. Sir, what are the examples of non-chloride salts? It can be lactate in lactic acidosis. It can be beta hydroxybutyrate in diabetic ketoacidosis. It can be hippurate in a case of toluene poisoning or glue sniffing. So, hence, if I say that which parameter takes the urinary acid excretion in its entirety, whether it's a chloride salt or a non-chloride salt, it is the urinary ammonium gap. So if at all there is an MCQ ever asked or an indirect question ever asked, which is a better marker of urinary acid excretion, answer is urinary osmolal gap is a better marker of urinary acid excretion. I hope I'm clear to all of you. Am I? Wonderful. Now, just the derivation logic of the same concept. In RTA, what happens? There is decrease in urinary acid. So, there will be decrease in urinary ammonium ion. And so, there will be decrease in urinary osmolal gap. But what did we study about urine anion gap? In RTA, the urine anion gap increases, the urine osmolal gap decreases. I hope I am absolutely clear to all of you. And let me now sum up everything in three lines for you. Everything will be summed up in three lines for you. Please say, if this is the urine anion gap, this is the urine osmolal gap. What is the normal value of urine anion gap? Sir, it is plus 30 to plus 50 millimoles per liter. What is the normal value of urine osmolal gap? It is plus 10 to plus 100 milliosmomoles per kg. Yeah. Okay. Now, what happens in RTA? The urine anion gap increases, the urine osmolal gap decreases. So basically, it is plus 20 to plus 90 milliosmomoles per liter, the urine anion gap in RTA. And what happens to urine osmolal gap? It is always less than 150 milliosmomoles per kg. What happens in diarrhea? Sir, in diarrhea there will be increase in urinary acid excretion. So there will be the urine anion gap will decrease. So here it will be minus 20 to minus 50 millimoles per liter. And this will increase because more the urinary ammonium, more the urine osmolal gap. And hence it will be more than 400 milliosmomoles per kg. If this table you remember, nobody can ask you a concept and can move you because you have understood everything from this concept. And now you have understood everything about the concept of RTA and the channelopathies. And now it is only a matter of correlation and tabulation, and hence it's a cakewalk for you. It's a cakewalk for you. I hope everybody understood. If you have, please tell me how's the Josh. How is the Josh? Just pause for 10 seconds. How's the Josh? Wonderful. It's always high. It has to be high. I always like enthusiastic people. So have the gusto, have the enthusiasm, always be bang on. Great, great Dr. Abhishek. Great Dr. Anil. So now, you almost understood everything. The last thing what I want to tell you is two things. Now, whenever there is metabolic acidosis, now if you all are making notes, if you are writing something, please write concepts, and I want to give you just two concepts. In metabolic acidosis, what happens? metabolic acidosis, always what it does is it causes mobilization of calcium from the bone. Always. And it causes decreased calcium reabsorption from kidneys. So number one, it causes increased mobilization of the calcium from the bone, and it causes a decreased calcium reabsorption from the kidneys. In short, there will be more calcium in the blood and less of calcium excreted and reabsorbed from the urine. So more calcium in the blood, more calcium in the urine. Hence, it leads to a state of hypercalciuria. And so this is true for everything. Whenever there is a state of metabolic acidosis, it is always toxic. I mean, it is always harmful for the bone, because the bone becomes weak, gets demineralized, and the urine reabsorption of calcium also decreases. This is just a concept. I want to, you know, just strike it in your heads just before making my wonderful little table for you all. Now, second thing, if you remember RTA type 2, just if you remember, there was decreased bicarbonate reabsorption because there is, and it leads to metabolic alkalosis. Now, you do know that whenever there is bicarbonate loss, there is also intravascular volume depletion. Because there is intravascular volume depletion, you know that whenever there is less of intravascular volume, which axis gets stimulated? You are correct, it is the RAS axis stimulation. Whenever there is RAS axis stimulation, you know that there is increase in sodium reabsorption and decrease in potassium reabsorption. In short, there is potassium excretion. Hence, what leads to hypokalemia. There is a hypokalemia. So if you remember, I told you about the potassium. In every RTA except RTA type 2 or the proximal RTA, what happens there, sir? There is hypokalemia in type 2 RTA, and why? I have told you. Now, Dr. Darshan Suchak has just requested me to repeat urinary osmolal gap. Now, just see what happens in diarrhea. Diarrhea is a disease of the gut or the kidney? It's a disease of the gut. Kidneys are intact. In diarrhea, you lose from apart from the fecal matter, you lose a lot of intestinal secretion rich in bicarbonate. So you develop metabolic acidosis. When you develop metabolic acidosis, your body has a tendency to excrete the acid as a compensatory form, and which better organ to excrete than the kidneys? In diarrhea, is the kidney intact or not? It's intact. So kidney will be able to excrete extra acid? Yes or no? Yes. Which form? Urinary ammonium form. So in diarrhea, there will be increase in urinary ammonium form. Yes, if there is increase in urinary ammonium salts, what is the osmolal gap? It is the difference between calculated minus measured and measured minus calculated, which is urinary ammonium salt. So more the ammonium salt, more the osmolal gap. Hence, the osmolal gap is more in urinary. Osmolal gap is more in diarrhea, more than 400 milliosmoles per kg. Thank you, Dr. Sakti Will. I hope you understood also. So this two concept I want you to just take it, okay? And now I shall not do anything. It is you who shall tell me all the answers and everything you already know by now. You already know by now. It is just a matter of writing now. It is just a matter of writing. And it will be a cakewalk, I'm pretty sure, for most of you. Okay? I hope Dr. Darshan has understood what I was saying. If yes, give me a thumbs up. I'll be happy. Now, whenever we shall go across this, what I want you all to do, Dr. Abhishek, Dr. Ruhi, Dr. VPS, Dr. Gurinder Pal, I just have a request that I want you to just in your mind, in your cortex, just try to recall the channel, the photograph which I just showed you. That is why, you know, I did not take a book photograph. I drew the channels in front of you. I drew the tubule photo. Why? Because schematic diagrams are easy to remember. Now, if you can just remember, visualize, I told you what your mind, what your eyes cannot see, your mind does not register. Just see the RT in front of your eyes. You will never forget. So now, let us just do it. RTA type 1, sir, the defect was in the alpha intercalated cell of the cortical collecting duct. Type 2, the defect was in the proximal convoluted tubule. Type 4, the defect was in the principal cell of cortical collecting duct. I can easily recall it, sir. Thank you very much. What is the mechanism defect in RTA type 1? Sir, if I can just recall, in the alpha cell of the intercalated duct, what happened was the acid was not being able to be excreted out. So here, there is defective acid excretion. It's a defect of acid excretion. In RTA type 2, what happens? There it is a defective bicarbonate reabsorption. Okay, so it's a defective bicarbonate reabsorption. So one is a defect of excretion, one a defect of reabsorption, one a defect of acid, one a defect of base. In RTA type 4, there is defective action of aldosterone on mineralocorticoid receptor. It's a defective action of aldosterone on the mineralocorticoid receptor. Okay? Now, serum anion gap, sir, we all know RTA as a whole belongs to the family. Sir, RTA ka father kaun hai? RTA ka father hai NAGMA or the normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. Or NAGMA ka father kaun hai? Metabolic acidosis. So we all know that inke grandfather the jiska naam tha metabolic acidosis, uske do bacche the. Wo ek tha HAGMA, ek tha NAGMA. Ek tha high anion gap metabolic acidosis, ek a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. NAGMA ke bahut sare bacche hain, but two you important to remember. One is RTA, one is diarrhea. I told you the difference between two. So what is serum anion gap? Sir, it is normal. It is normal. It is normal. What is urine anion gap in RTA? I told you, sir, it is always positive, always positive, always positive. And I also told you it is always more than 20, always more than 20, always more than 20. What happens to urine osmolal gap? So you told me it decreases. It is less than 150. It is less than 150. It is less than 150. Now, you know, some books, they try to complicate things. They will give you different mechanistic and physiological channel explanations of these. They will say it can be this, can be that. Please understand, for MCQ purpose, this is the dictum, this is the rule. Take it from me. Okay? This is the answer. This will be the answer. Try to simplify things. Don't try to complicate things. Alright? Now, sir, you told me in RTA type 1, alpha intercalated cell, potassium was being absorbed in exchange of hydrogen, which will not take place. So what will I get of serum potassium? Low. In RTA type 2, you just told me the RAS axis activation potassium is low. In RTA type 4, aldosterone acted and was kicking out the potassium of the cell, but it will not happen. So what will I get? I will get RTA type 4 mein hyperkalemia, and this is a done to death question. This is a done to death question which is still asked in FMGE, NEET PG, NEET SS, MRCP, USMLE questions. What is known as hyperkalemic RTA? Answer is type 4. That is why RTA type 4 is also known as hyperkalemic RTA. If you do this question wrong, please let me tell you, your chances of getting selected are absolutely going to be go down, because this is bread and butter. This is bread and butter for a medicine aspirant. What is a potassium in RTA type 4? What about urinary calcium? So you just told me something. What you told me was that in acidosis, there is increase in mobilization from the bone and decrease in urinary reabsorption. So there will be increase in urinary calcium. Now, Out of these three, just tell me one thing. What did I tell you is the most important site of acid excretion in the kidney? It is the alpha intercalated cell. Or in tino mesa, which is the defect of the alpha intercalated cell? It is type 1. So that type which has the defect of that site, which is mostly responsible for acidifying urine, that will lead to maximum acidosis. Maximum acidosis means maximum urinary calcium. So here the urinary calcium is highest. In RTA type 2, acidosis is there, but it is of lesser degree, so it will be just high. In RTA type 4, acidosis is very, very mild, so urinary calcium is often normal or slightly raised. Okay, come to urinary citrate. Wonderful, very, very important. Now, I told you in my diagram that urinary citrate is reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule. Did I or did I not? So, you did tell us. Now, so which is the defect of the PCT here? RTA type 2. So in RTA type 2, the citrate will not get reabsorbed through the PCT and the urine will contain a lot of citrate. And here in RTA type 1, the PCT is intact. So urine will not contain citrate. It will not contain citrate. Same here, the PCT is intact, the urine will not contain citrate. Now just try to understand this concept. Please try to understand this concept about citrate. Do not destroy this table. Okay, do not destroy this table. Let the beauty remain. Now, something about citrate. Now, you know, I am a very simple person, so I see citrate as a very, very simple thing. I see citrate, I call citrate as the guardian of calcium. Just like I called complement factor H the guardian of the alternate complement pathway. Whenever a factor H goes out for shopping, alternate complement pathway, you know, bacche starts enjoying, they go out haywire and they create havoc. And what not they create? They create atypical us, they create C3 glomerulopathy and whatnot. Similarly, citrate, what it does is, it is a guardian of calcium. Whenever there is not citrate and only calcium, calcium are, you know, they want to mingle with each other, they want to crystallize. But citrate is something, it prevents calcium accumulation and it prevents calcium crystallization. So basically, citrate wo aunt hai, wo guardian hai, jiske presence mein calcium jaise naughty bacche will never be able to create havoc. They will never be able to mingle closely with each other and create havoc in the kidney. Just remember this. So more calcium, more citrate means guardian is there, no havoc. More calcium, no citrate, you know, havoc. Just now come here. You now by know that in RTA type 1, there is increase, very much increase in urinary calcium, but there is no citrate. It means havoc. So there will be nephrolithiasis, nephrocalcinosis. In RTA type 2, there is urinary calcium, but there is also the guardian. In fact, the guardian is more than the person creating havoc. No chance of stone. And here the urinary calcium is only low, so no chance of stone. In short, you have got the second done to death question. The second done to death question, which RTA has stones or nephrocalcinosis? Answer is type 1. I have taught you two questions which you cannot afford to mark wrong even in your deepest REM sleep. Answer 1 is hyperkalemic RTA type 4. Second is stone forming RTA type 1. Never ever mark it wrong. Especially after this class. Now. Urinary pH. Now please understand, RTA 1 mein alpha intercalated cell hai defective, which is the site of acidification of urine. So in RTA type 1, there will be least acidification of urine. Am I true or understood? Have you understood? So if there will be least acidified urine, here the least urine pH will be more than 5.5. So can I say which RTA has the least acidic urine? Answer is RTA type 1. coming to RTA type 2. Sir, in RTA type 2, what happens? In RTA type 2, my alpha intercalated cell is intact. So, my urine acidification will happen. If my urine acidification will happen, the urine least pH will be less than 5.5, and so too in RTA type 4. So in RTA type 2 and 4, my urine pH is less than 5.5, but in RTA type 1, it is always more than 5.5. The next point which I have been teaching and I have been telling my students for ages, but finally I got some respite when the Ames SS Nephrology paper 2021 asked a question on fractional excretion of bicarbonate. People used to study fractional excretion of sodium, phena, but I always was interested in telling you FeHCO3 also. You know that bicarbonate is reabsorbed in RTA type 2, so FeHCO3 is more than 15% in RTA type 2, but it is less than 5% in RTA type 1 and RTA type 4, and hence, you know, you'll be happy to know that this question was asked in the Ames Nephrology 2021 Super Speciality Entrance Exam, that what is the fractional excretion of bicarbonate in RTA type 2? Answer is more than 15%. More than 15%. Now, moving on. Now, I told you that RTA type 1 has the most severe acidosis. Because why? Because it has the least acidic urine. Easy to understand. So now, the serum bicarbonate, which shows a degree of metabolic acidosis, is highest here. So here the serum bicarbonate is lowest. It is usually less than 12 milliequivalents per liter. It is 12 to 18 here, and it is here 18 to 22. Actually, RTA type 4 is a very, very mild form of acidosis. Okay. What about Fanconi syndrome? Sir, you all know this, studied right from first year biochemistry. What is Fanconi's? Probably you don't understand that much. I just showed you in the diagram that in PCT, you have the reabsorption of glucose, phosphate, citrate, bicarbonate, amino acid and whatnot. If for any damn reason, there is a global dysfunction of PCT, there is a global PCT dysfunction, so then what will I get? I will get glycosuria, phosphate urea, citrate urea, bicarbonate urea, amino acid urea. Add urea as a suffix in everything that is getting reabsorbed. And what is that is known as? That is known as Fanconi syndrome. And of course, it's a PCT dysfunction. So it can only happen in type 2, never happen in type 1 or type 4. I hope I'm clear to you. Now, presentation. Now, at the end of the day, we all are clinicians. What matters the most to us is how this patient will come to me in the OPD or in the casualty. Now, in RTA type 1, the usual presentation is it presents with features of hypokalemia. Now, that hypokalemia can present to you with muscular weakness. If it's a chronic hypokalemia, it can present to me as a nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, because you know chronic hypokalemia prevents the insertion of aquaporin 2 in the collecting duct, medullary collecting duct. So there is impaired reabsorption of water, leads to nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. What else? Of course, it leads to nephrocalcinosis. Goes without saying. These are the two chief presentations. Coming to RTA type 2, here again you have hypokalemia, but you never have stones. What do you have here? Here I get features of hypophosphatemia. Again, hypophosphatemia can have, what can it have? It can have muscular weakness. Hypophosphatemia is severe, can lead to what not? The neurology people know it much, much better than me. What else? There is also vitamin D deficiency, because you know the PCT is also responsible for secreting the 1-alpha hydroxylase that converts calcidiol to calcitriol. So there is decreased secretion of 1-alpha hydroxylase enzyme. No, there is more bicarbonate loss in RTA type 2, but you know that bicarbonate just cannot be taken in isolation from the loss by the kidneys. It is also the state of generation and the state of metabolic acidosis in toto. because bicarbonate reserve actually it is a holistic thing and it represents the state the metabolic state of the body. So more the acidosis will show lesser the bicarbonate, or paradoxically lesser the bicarbonate, more the acidosis. Okay, Dr. Aishwarya Joshi. Coming to RTA type 4, what happens here? Here usually there it presents with a mild hyperkalemia. Usually the potassium is between 5.5 to 6. You all must be knowing in your medicine residency, you must be very frequently getting calls from other departments for references for, you know, potassium of 5.8, 5.9. Okay. And actually, usually it is the medicine people who call the nephrology people. Sorry. Very often I get calls from medicine department and they are telling me to see patients for mild hyperkalemia. When I go there, inevitably the patient is a diabetic, inevitably the creatinine is around 1.5 to 2, the GFR is around 60, 60, 40, CKD G3A, G3B, and this is usually the presentation. And you know it's a RTA type 4. So usually they present with mild hyperkalemia and they have a mild to moderate renal dysfunction. But of course, this renal dysfunction is not due to RTA. It is actually contributes to RTA. Okay? Not an effect, but a cause. Last but not the least, what is the treatment? Nothing. In RTA type 1, what will you do? You will, of course, give alkali to the patient. And you will treat the cause. So if you attended my truly clinical session, I discussed about the Sjogren syndrome presenting as RTA type 1, presenting as hypokalemic paralysis. So what did I give there? I supplemented potassium, I supplemented alkali, and I treated the cause. I treated Sjogren, I gave the patient hydroxychloroquine and steroid, the patient improved. In type 2, what do you want to give? You want to give alkali, potassium, you want to give vitamin D, you want to give phosphate. Okay. RTA type 4, what do you want to give? Of course, there is hyperkalemia here. So inevitably, you want to restrict potassium. You want to stop the offending drugs. Most often, the patient is taking an ACE inhibitor, ARB, or a ketoconazole, or a heparin. Stop the offending drug. And you can also give a trial of fludrocortisone. Why, sir? Because it's a analog of mineralocorticoid. So you know there is a mineralocorticoid qualitative or quantitative deficiency here. So fludrocortisone might work. But again, it has a risk factor of causing increase in hypertension in the patient. So with this, we come to the end of the renal tubular acidosis. If there are some questions in the chat box, I can see. I'll answer it later on. I don't want to extend the session. So we have understood RTA right from the physiology, the anion gap, the osmolal gap. We understood where does the defect lie, what is the mechanism, what is the serum anion gap, what is the urine anion gap, urine osmolal gap, serum potassium, urine calcium, citrate, stones, presentation, treatment, everything. Everything we have understood. So you know these 14-15 points, if you can understand the concept, if you can reproduce the entire table on your own before the exam, not a single exam can ask you anything beyond this. Let me tell you very, very honestly. Even at the DM level, this knowledge will be, with the concept, is more than sufficient. More than sufficient. Just to complete, okay. So what I'll have to discuss this as well. Now, many students might be wondering, sir, you discussed type 1, 2, 4. Is your knowledge leaking or what? Why did you miss 3? Let me complete type 3 also. So 3 is a, first of all, it's a very rare disorder. It's a very, very rare disorder and it's an autosomal recessive disorder. So it's a very rare disorder. Less than 100 cases have been reported till yet. Of course, no chance of my seeing such a patient. So here, there is a mutation of carbonic anhydrase. 2. So here the defect is in the carbonic anhydrase 2 enzyme. Now you do know the carbonic anhydrase 2 enzyme played an important part in both the things. Where, sir, it played an important role in the PCT, in bicarbonate reabsorption, and in the alpha intercalated cell in the acid excretion. So what it does it lead to? There is defective. So what it leads to? It leads to bicarbonate urea, and it leads to defective acid excretion. So is it not simulating feature of type 2 RTA plus type 1 RTA? So we had studied in mathematics in our kindergartens that 3 is 1 plus 2 is equal to 3, but here in nephrology I have proved it to you once again, the golden rule that 3 is equal to 1 plus 2. So type 3 RTA is equal to type 2 RTA plus type 1 RTA, because it's a defect of the parent enzyme known as carbonic anhydrase type 2, which will lead to defects of both bicarbonate reabsorption and acid excretion, that is type 2 and type 1 RTA. So it is type 3 RTA is equal to type 2 plus type 1 RTA. So what will it present to you with? Sir, it will have features of both, but important MCQ points. What does it present to you with? Sir, it presents to me with number 1, osteopetrosis with mental retardation and cerebral calcification, and that is why it is known as marble brain disease. This is all you need to know from this. This is all you need to know. Okay? Alright. So, marble brain disease is another fancy name for type 3 RTA. Now, just before we end this, to complete the RTA topic in its toto, one thing we can just try to recap, which we all know of course, are the causes of RTA. Let me just make a schematic diagram, and please do not get amazed. This is not an Ichhadhari Nag. This is my version of a nephron. Okay. Do not get amazed. Okay. To give you context, yes, this is your. Yes. So now maybe you can find some simulation or some similarity with a nephron. Okay. Do not get horrified. So somewhere here is your PCT. Somewhere here is your principal cell, and maybe somewhere here is your alpha intercalated cell. Okay, this is your cortical collecting duct. Now you know that your defect of PCT leads to type 2 or proximal RTA. Defect of the principal cell leads to type 4 RTA, and defect of type 1 leads to type 1 or distal RTA. Now there are many causes of each RTA. Sometimes it can be quite nagging and difficult to remember also, but just simple thing how I remember them, I just want to tell you guys. We all are friends, so let me just tell you. Now, most of you have understood the fact that, sir, MD se to mera kuch hoga nahi, So you have made your MD degree a vamp. Okay, but let me tell you, I still love internal medicine the most, and I'm still an internist at heart. Okay. So sir, why have you made it? Because sir, W for Wilson's, A for amyloid, M for myeloma, P for PNH or paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, M for metabolic diseases, and D for drugs. Sir, which drugs? The drugs that can cause are lead, mercury, what else? Topiramate, ifoxamide, so on. So basically, the causes of type 2 RTA are VAMP, MD, Wilson's, amyloid, myeloma, PNH, metabolic diseases. Sir, what are the metabolic diseases you know of? It is of course the cystinosis, the tyrosinemia, cystinuria, and so on. So these are the causes of type 2 RTA, and most often they are very fond of asking Wilson's disease, they are fond of asking lead, they can ask topiramate. Acha, one question I want to tell you about topiramate. Sir, you told me that type 2 RTA has no stones. Tell me a cause of type 2 RTA that can cause stones. Answer is topiramate. It can cause stones. We have studied this in pharmacology from KD Tripathi right in our second year MBBS. Topiramate can cause stones. It's an anti-epileptic. All the neurology aspirants know better than me. It can cause stones because it causes increase in urinary pH, it causes hypocitrate urea, and so on. So topiramate as an exception, cause of type 2 RTA, but can lead to stones. Okay, coming to type 4 RTA. Now type 4 RTA is again, the cause are the Dado. The cause is Dado. Please don't get horrified at my mnemonic. I'm very poor at it. It is of course diabetes mellitus. It is adrenocortical insufficiency in the form of Addison's. It is drugs and obstructive uropathy. And what are the drugs that can cause type 4 RTA? It is the trimethoprim. It is the ACE inhibitor, ARB. It is the spironolactone. It is the heparin. It is the calcineurin inhibitor, very important for renal transplant physicians to know this. The ketoconazole. And so this is it. So the causes are diabetes, Addison's, drugs, and obstructive uropathy. Okay, all right. And just to tell you, one of the exam that had appeared for was MRCP. In MRCP part 1, I was asked this question, that obstructive uropathy leads to which type of RTA. It was basically a clinical oriented long 5-6 liner, and the basic SAR of the question was this one. Coming to type 1 RTA. Type 1 RTA, what are the causes? Again, the causes are, you know, they give me a lot of agony from the very beginning. I have wanted to learn something to impress girls, but neither I could manage to learn this nor could I impress girls. What are the causes of type 1 RTA? It was my favorite, Sjögren syndrome, amphotericin B, asked n number of times, lithium, SLE, sickle cell anemia, and autoimmune diseases like SLE, like primary biliary cirrhosis. Okay, so these are the causes of type 1, 2, and 4. If you are there with me, if you have somewhat laughed at my mnemonics, please give me a thumbs up. I'll be happy. Give me a thumbs up. Type 2 RTA, it is a VAMP MD. Type 4, it is the Dado. Type 1, Sjögren syndrome, asked umpteen number of times. Amphotericin B, asked umpteen number of times. Lithium, sickle cell anemia, and autoimmune diseases like primary biliary cirrhosis and systemic lupus erythematosus. I hope you have understood, you have enjoyed learning renal tubular acidosis, which unanimously all of you told me that sir, questions nahi hote, I get wrong, mark them wrong, I get confused. Thank you, Dr. Nitish, for that validation. Sometimes when you do Lean things, you do require validation. And I hope, you know, even those people who were not, they have not done MD medicine, I have understood, because I have tried to explain right from the basics. Okay. Yeah, dense disease can, it's also a metabolic disease, X-linked recessive nephrolithiasis, mutation of CLCN2, it can also cause Fanconi syndrome and proximal artery as well. Okay. Great. Now we have already exceeded time, so just tell me, we are still left with the portion of channelopathies. Are you ready to sit with me for another half an hour, or you want me to take it another session? I want you to all tell me this. If you all tell me, then I will shall start. If not, I shall take another session on channelopathies. Please tell me quickly whether you want to study channelopathy, that is the different syndromes, right? Because basics you have studied. Now if you want me to jot it down, I will continue. I need at least 10 thumbs up if you want me to continue. Wow. So Gurinder Pal Singh ji is telling me now, I would love to do it now as well. Continue. So I have got only Dr. Padma to take it tomorrow. Continue. I want to go with the majority of the house. So what does the house say? Let's finish it. That's the attitude. Abhishek, tum bologe to kaise chalega? Chalo, let's complete it in 15 minutes. What say? Let's finish it. Chalo. Yes, that's it. Now, if you just remember what we have already studied, just let me just recapitulate. There was a sodium potassium 2 chloride symport in the PCT, and that if got loss of function mutation, it led to a syndrome known as Bartter syndrome. There was a sodium potassium chloride symport in the distal convoluted tubule, jiska when happened loss of function mutation, it led to a syndrome known as Gittleman syndrome. Iska when there was a gain of function mutation, it led to, yes, there is only one gainer of this world, known as Gordon's syndrome. And Gordon's syndrome is also known as pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 2. Pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 2. Now, we came to the INACT channel in the principal cell of the collecting duct. And ISCA, when there was a gain of function mutation, I hope you remember what is gain, LOF and GOF. I hope you remember that. What happened here? It was something known as Liddle's syndrome. And ISICA, when there was a loss of function mutation, I told you the mirror image, it is known as pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 1. Pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 1. So, this is a disorder of the thick ascending loop of Henle. This is a disorder of the DCT, and this is a disorder of the principal cell of the cortical collecting duct. So just to, you know, put it in front of you in a very, very simple manner. These disorders we have already told you the basics about. Okay. Now, one more syndrome I would just want to tell you, that is syndrome of apparent mineralocorticoid excess, SAME. Here, there is defect of the enzyme 11-beta-HSD2, which is the 11-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase 2. What it does is, it converts cortisol to cortisone. Now, in its deficiency, this is not taking place. Because this is not taking place, wait, many of you will get confused. Let me write it. So, in deficiency of 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase 2, maybe it's a congenital one, maybe it's due to licorice ingestion, what happens? This conversion does not take place and there is excess of cortisol. What happens? Cortisone is a fairly inactive form of cortisol, but it does not happen, so there is more cortisol. Cortisol is so notorious. Cortisol, we all know, it's a glucocorticoid. Apart from being a glucocorticoid, it has mineralocorticoid activity also. And you'll be surprised to know it has mineralocorticoid activity more than aldosterone itself. It has mineralocorticoid activity a lot, even more than the principal mineralocorticoid. So what happens if there is deficiency of beta 11 beta HSD2? There is not defective conversion from cortisol to inactive cortisone. So more cortisol, it stimulates. So this increased cortisol, it stimulates the mineralocorticoid receptor again and again, and it leads to what? It leads to a state of what? Hyper. It's state as if the aldosterone is more, so it leads to increased sodium, increased blood pressure, decreased potassium and metabolic alkalosis. So it is like dur se dekha to aldosterone zyada tha, पास जाकर देखा तो कॉर्टिजोल ही था और एसएएमई ही था. ओके, सो इट अपीयर एज इफ एल्डोस्टेरोन इज हाई, बट एक्चुअली इट इज अ कॉर्टिजोल विच इज स्टिम्युलेटिंग द रिसेप्टर ऑफ द एल्डोस्टेरोन. सो दिस यू हैव ऑल अंडरस्टूड, एंड नाउ लेट मी टेक अप माय ब्यूटिफुल टेबल एंड लेट अस कंसाइज इन द इंटायर नॉलेज in one table. And what will we do? We shall write it in one table. Now, what is the defect in the Bartter syndrome? It is a defect of the sodium potassium 2 chloride symport in the thick ascending loop of Henle, and the gene is SLC12A1. The inheritance is, of course, autosomal recessive. You know, you have already made you right. There is less of sodium reabsorption, less of potassium reabsorption. There is hypotension. There is alkalosis. Of course, if there is hypotension, the RAS axis will get stimulated. What is the treatment? Sir, in Bartter syndrome, due to increased urinary prostaglandins, so you can inhibit it. So you can give NSAID, principally endomethacin. Coming to Gittleman syndrome. Gittleman syndrome, the site of the defect is a sodium chloride symport which lies in the DCT, which is the SLC12A3 gene. Again, it is also autosomal recessive. Now, please try to, you know, answer it yourself. This just table needs to be filled. Not my requirement anymore. There is hyponatremia, hypokalemia, hypotension, metabolic alkalosis. The RAS axis is stimulated. And how do you treat it? You don't treat with endomethacin. You just give a supplementation of potassium supplementation. So how do you, basically, many of you might, I'll do that later. First, let me complete this table. Now, what about Gordon syndrome? Sir, Gordon is the gainer, just the mirror image. So this is the loss of function mutation, and here you have the gain of function mutation of the sodium chloride symport. Now actually it is not the channel's gain of function mutation, actually it is a mutation of the regulators. So here, strictly speaking, it is a mutation of regulators of NCC, sodium chloride channel. And what are they? It is the WNT1, WNT4, KHL3, CUL3. These are the regulators. Okay. It is autosomal dominant. So you get a difference. And it is a mirror image. What do you get here? Sir, sare arrows reverse kar do. No need to think. And how will you treat Gordon? Sir, the channel here hyperactive is the sodium chloride channel, which is a channel where which diuretic acts? Block it. Give thiazide diuretic. Coming to Liddle syndrome now. Liddle syndrome. Let me just change the, let me remain, make it the same. Now, Liddle syndrome, I told you, it is the defect of the, it is the gain of function channel of the ENaC channel. Here, it is again autosomal dominant. What happens here? Sir, there is increase in sodium, low in potassium, there is increase in blood pressure, there is alkalosis. The RAS axis, if there is hypertension, will be lower. And how will you treat it? Sir, block the ENaC channel. And what is the blocker of the ENaC channel known as? Amiloride. Amiloride. What is pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 1? Here again the inheritance is AR. It is here the nothing but the loss of function of the ENaC channel. What will you do here, sir? Just reverse the arrows. Just reverse the arrows. No need to apply any brain. Make it simpler for me. So here what is happening? The ENaC channel is functioning less. So I am getting less of sodium, more of potassium. I am getting hypotension. So what can I do here? I can make the ENaC channel somehow try to work more, or I can make the mineralocorticoid receptor work more. So I can give your supplementation of sodium. I can give potassium blockers. Or I can even try a fludrocortisone. Last but not the least, the syndrome of apparent mineralocorticoid excess. Here the defect is the 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase 2. Of course, the inheritance is autosomal recessive. I told you it behaves as if there is more aldosterone. More aldosterone means more sodium, less potassium, more BP. Alkalosis. The RAS axis is what? The RAS axis is down. The treatment is what? Block the mineralocorticoid receptor. The treatment is spironolactone. With this, we have summed up all the channelopathies again in one simple table. Now, let me tell you some important, interesting MCQ points out of these. If you can clearly notice here, there is only one syndrome. There is only one syndrome which has both hyperkalemia and hypertension together. Only one syndrome which has hyperkalemia and hypertension together. So, that is Gordon syndrome. That is why Gordon syndrome is known as familial hyperkalemic hypertension. It is the familial hyperkalemic hypertension. Now, Liddle syndrome is also known as pseudo hyperaldosteronism because it functions simulate as if there is more aldosterone in the body. So it is known, also known as pseudo-hyperaldosteronism. RAS basically is the renin-aldosterone axis I am talking about. I am talking about the renin-aldosterone axis. Okay, Dr. Manoj. Now, if I have to just give you a trick of for each Bartter syndrome, it mimics loop diuretic. Gittleman syndrome, it mimics thiazide diuretic. Gordon's is the opposite of Gittleman. Liddle's, just remember ENaC. PHA1 is the opposite of Liddle's, and SAME stimulates it. It mimics increase in aldosterone. I have just made a mistake which Dr. Isha has correctly pointed out. You are absolutely correct, ma'am. In PHA 1, which is the opposite of Liddell's, the RAS axis will be stimulated, not depressed. Not depressed. You are absolutely correct. Please make this correction. Yeah, so I was telling you about the questions. Gordon syndrome is known as familial hyperkalemic hypertension. Okay, it is also known as familial hyperkalemic hypertension. This is a very important question. Liddell's is often asked. Liddell's is again often asked. SAME is often asked. Now SAME mimics. SAME mein it one cause is licorice ingestion. Very, very important. This is again an MCQ. So now you have understood in toto about the different channelopathies. One of you did ask me about why in Bartter's you give indomethacin. So basically, if you just have a look about Bartter's and Gittleman, sir, dono mein hi there is low sodium, low potassium, low blood pressure and metabolic alkalosis. It is the same for both. Are they not looking very, very similar to you clinically? So how will I differentiate whether it's a Bartter or a Gittleman's? I can differentiate by what? I can differentiate by urinary calcium. See, Bartter's is a syndrome that simulates, that mimics loop diuretics. And you know loop diuretics cause hypercalciuria. So there is hypercalciuria here and there is hypocalciuria. Because you know, thiazides are used for hypercalciuria. Next. Hypomagnesemia, serum magnesium. Now, serum magnesium is usually normal in Bartter, but it is hypomagnesemic in Gittleman syndrome in almost 100% patients, but it is low in 20% patient of Bartter's. So, hypomagnesemia will definitely point out to you Gittleman syndrome. So there is hypercalciuria, hypomagnesemia in Gittleman's. Next, pathophysiologically it was found that urinary prostaglandin levels, it was high and it was normal in Gittleman's. Because it was higher, so the physicians thought, why not treat it and give us something which inhibits prostaglandins. So I gave NSAIDs here, like indomethacin, and here NSAIDs don't work. Because there is increase in urinary prostaglandins in Bartter's syndrome. So both of them might appear similar electrolyte acid based balance to you, but calcium, magnesium and response to indomethacin and of course the genetic studies will help you to differentiate between the two. I hope I am clear. I want a thumbs up and a smiley from all of you. So sorry for extending the time. Just doing it for you. Exams around the corner. I want to cover maximum things. This is not only for nephrology, mind you. It can come in any part of medicine. Okay. Now, I did discuss in the very beginning about the types of Bartter. I told you there are 5 types of Bartters. Did I not? And if nothing is mentioned, only mentioned Bartters. So, you know Bartter type 1 is a defect of sodium potassium 2 chloride jo hum log itne der se pad rahe hain. Type 2 anticlockwise, remember? If you remember type 2, it was ROMK channel. Type 3, the chloride channel on the basolateral aspect. Type 4, the Barton subunit of the chloride channel. And type 5, which many people now debate about, it is due to calcium sensing receptor, now also known as autosomal dominant hypocalcemia. Okay. Now, important MCQ point. I have taken this table from up to date. Most of you might have understood now. Type 1 is antenatal Bartter syndrome. Type 2, again antenatal Bartter syndrome. Type 4, again antenatal Bartter syndrome. So you know most Bartters, type 1, type 2, type 4, present antenatally, that is before birth. But that Bartters which you and me as adult nephrologists will see, that is type 3, which presents later in life, and this is known as classic Bartter syndrome, which was asked in NEET Super Speciality 2019. It was asked in NEET Super Speciality 2019 that which Bartter syndrome is known as classic Bartter syndrome. Answer is type 3. Answer is type 3. This type 1, 2, 4 antenatal, type 3 classic. Last MCQ from this topic is which Bartter has deafness associated? Which Bartter has deafness? Answer is type 4. Answer is type 4. Why, sir? Why, sir? Because in type 4, if you remember, it is the defect of the Bartin, and Bartin also is there in the inner ear. So I am repeating the questions. Type 1, 2, 4 antenatal, type 3 Bartter, type 4 deafness. Just remember these. And type 5 autosomal dominant hypocalcemia. All are AR. It is only type 5 which is autosomal dominant. Rest, all of them are autosomal recessive. Now another addition, last point, pakka last from this. There is another new cause of Bartter syndrome which is due to the mutation of melanoma associated antigen D2, which is MAGD2. So some people who are fanatic about recent updates, newer things, you can have an antenatal Bartter syndrome due to mutation of one more gene, which is the melanoma associated antigen D2. I'm just repeating myself. 1, 2, 4 antenatal, 3 classic or adult onset Bartter, type 4 is sensory neural hearing loss, type 5 is the only autosomal dominant, and last but not the least, the MAGD2 antigen, the melanoma associated antigen, is a newer antigen. Just remember these MCQs. You are good to go. Okay. And to conclude with a question, can you see who can solve? Let me see who can solve this question first. And I will give a round of applause in front of everyone who solves this. A 32-year-old woman with psychotic illness was referred to asymptomatic hypokalemia. On examination, the BP was on the lower side. So there is sodium is 133 on the lower side, potassium is 2.9 on the lower side, blood pressure is on the lower side, magnesium is again on the lower side, 24-hour urinary calcium is again on the lower side. Sir, kuch chahiye ab aur? Do you require anything else? Bartter syndrome mein there will not be hypocalciuria or hypomagnesemia. Liddle syndrome mein there is hypertension. Cannot be. Self-induced vomiting, not at all. Answer is. I am waiting for the answer. Wonderful. That's my boys. And the person who has marked the correct answer first is Gittleman syndrome. And yes, round of applause for Dr. Anil Kumar KR. I am very, very happy with you. Answer is Gittleman. Why Gittle? T for Gittle, T for thiazide, T for DCT. Please call it Gittleman. Why? If you call it Gittleman, you pronounce T most prominently, and that is for thiazide, and you know the defect is in the DCT. Wonderful. All of you knew the answer, I'm pretty sure. But Dr. Anil Kumar is the first one to answer me. With this, I would like to call off this session, and of course reciting my favoritest lines in both in my PG and super speciality preparation times. I used to listen to this song again and again, and I would just like to help you. You are just my friends, my colleagues, and we'll be fellow nephrologists, cardiologists, neurologists. Some of you might be giving references to me, and I will be giving references to you to manage my patients, because you all are so brilliant and so worthy doctors. So, you know, just to keep the josh high, दांत से काट ले बिजली तार, चबा ले तांबे की छनकार, फूंक दे खुद को ज्वाला ज्वाला, बिन खुद जले न होए उजाला, लपट है आग मिल्खा आग, मिल्खा आग मिल्खा, अब तू भाग मिल्खा, अब तू जाग मिल्खा. सो आई नो ऑल ऑफ यू आर ऑलरेडी भागिंग, ऑल ऑफ यू आर ऑलरेडी जागिंग, बट दिस इज जस्ट फ्रॉम योर ब्रदर, फ्रॉम योर फ्रेंड डॉक्टर विवेक, अ मोटिवेशन, just a pat on your back that whatever you are doing, just continue to do. It is just a matter of 2 months and you'll be flying and soaring high. And I want to see all of you in the institutes of your choice with the dream subjects of your choice, which you all have been aiming for since you were a child. With this, thank you so much. It was a lovely session discussing. Of course, I was not teaching you because I am myself a student. I'm trying to learn. This was just a mutual exchange of information. I hope you loved it. I hope you liked it. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you learned. Definitely you taught me a lot. Thank you so much. So parindon ko manzil milegi yakeen hai. Ye phele hue unke par bolte hain. Aksar wo log khamosh rehte hain jinke zamane mein jinke hunar bolte hain. So I know you will only let your rank, your hard work do the talking, and not, you don't need to prove a point to anyone. It is just about yourself. Thank you so much. It was a beautiful, beautiful session connecting with all the lovely medicos. Thank you so much, Gurinder Palji. Paji, thank you so much. And lovely, all the very best. It's getting late. So if you have any session, if you have any questions, you can definitely send me on the WhatsApp group. I will solve each and every query. Thank you so much. Enjoy your dinners. Sastri Akal, Chabba Khair. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Om Gangai.